So I want to share with you some of the tools that I have used to optimize my life that hopefully you'll find valuable to you. I got a question for you. The first question is this: why do you want to be a PA? Why do you want to be a PA? Seriously, why do you want to be a PA? What's your motivation? What's your fuel? Now, I know what you wrote on your resume, your essay. I know what you wrote. You wrote, I want to help people and I want to be this and I want to be this. Okay, I get this, but why do you really want to be a PA? Now, I can tell you for me, my fuel was very hot. It was a lot of ego, and ambition. I didn't graduate high school on time because there's part of me, I wanted to make it. I wanted to be something in life. So I had a lot of ego as a new, and I'm not saying I don't have ego now. I do. But as a new graduate, I was going to make something of my life. Okay. So my fuel was ego and ambition. Why do you want to be a PA? And I'll tell you this. The more proportionate your ego is invested, my experience is the more this test is going to be scary to you. The more you think it's about you and your ego, the more this test may intimidate you. And that's been my experience. As I've grown a little bit in maturity, maybe a little spiritual growth, now I look at my role as a PA of a different fuel. It's just not the same as it was before. When I get my mindset in a servant's role, how can I help others? How can I help others? How can I realize maybe it's not about me? Maybe it's not about me. Maybe it's about you guys. Maybe it's about helping you. Maybe it's not about me anymore. When you can get your mind into a servant's mindset, a lot of fear goes away. Colleagues, listen to this. Maybe the boards aren't about you. Maybe you're not that big of a deal in the grand scheme of things. Maybe your patients are a really big deal. So maybe it's not about you. Maybe it's about your patients. And you have a stepping stone. You have a milestone called the pants. Everybody takes it. Everybody goes through it. Maybe it's not about you. Maybe it's about your patients. And I'm going to say something that I don't necessarily believe, but I believe it's true for some. Maybe the best thing for your patients is that you fail your boards once or twice. Maybe it is. Maybe you need to dial in your mind. Maybe you got your mind better. Maybe if it's not about you, maybe that's the best thing for you. Now, I don't necessarily believe it's true, but if it's about your patients and you believe that's true, then that should be an acceptable thing. Bottom line is, I have to realize it's not about me. How do I serve you guys? And quite frankly, I look at you and go, I don't even think it's about you. It's about your patients. I can look right now at Michelle and go, guess what? She gets into primary care medicine. There's a pretty good chance that she's going to see between 2,000 and 3,000 patients per year. Okay, in 10 years, she's going to see about 30, 40,000 patients. That's a very big deal. For the 55 people who are online right now, if you guys see 2,000, 3,000 patients in the next year, and I have the very small privilege of affecting that, I might affect 150,000 patients. That's a big deal. But maybe it's not about you. Maybe it's not about me. What's your fuel? Seriously, what's driving you? Because if it's ego, this test is going to be very intimidating. What will people think? Okay, maybe it's not about you. Maybe it's about service. That's helped me tremendously in my career. Now, I just ask you, why do you want to be a PA? Just think about it. Why do you want to be a PA? You know, that's an important question for me. And that's the first thing I'd ask. If you guys, if you want to take some notes, just take these bullet points as this talk goes on. Why do you want to be a PA? And maybe spend a little time on that. Next thing is, if you want to really learn to manage your states, you got to know who this guy is. This guy's name is James Stockdale. Now, James Stockdale was a fighter pilot who was shot down in Vietnam. He spent 7 years in a North Vietnamese POW camp, tortured every day. 7 years. Now, when he was finally rescued, they said, James, why did you live? Why did you live? And he said, I'll tell you exactly why I live. Now, what James said has been coined the Stockdale paradox. He said, I'll tell you exactly why I lived. He said, I lived because I was brutally honest with the facts. I was not an optimist. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, I'm in a POW camp in North Vietnam. I'm a fighter pilot that bombed people. There's a good chance I'm going to die here. That's the brutal facts. The optimists all died. They lost hope. So colleagues, if you want to start learning to control your emotional state, you got to be brutally honest with your life. You got to be brutally honest, man. You got to be honest. Not make it worse than it is or better than it is, but you got to see your life as it is. Be honest. How much have you studied throughout your program? Have you blown off studies? Did you go through rotations and take 6 weeks, a couple months where you coasted? Just be honest. Don't blame your program on that. But some people do that. They go through their, I'll cram it at the end. Okay, it doesn't mean we can't salvage it, but you better be honest about it. But also we said, have faith. Have faith. Everything's going to be okay. Everything will be okay. That's the Stockdale paradox. Be honest. Be brutally honest, but have faith. My experience is honesty can be very difficult because we have subconscious motivations. I had to get honest to save my life. I had to learn who I was. What was most important for me to save, to be really honest? Journaling. I journal all the time. It's very, very difficult to bullshit yourself when you're journaling. It's just very difficult. When you're journaling, it's very, very hard to tell something that's not accurate. But I also got people in my life that I could talk to, that they cared about my life more than they cared about my feelings. So they would tell me when I wasn't thinking right. That's a Stockdale paradox. So step one, if you want, why do you want to be a PA? What's your fuel? Step two, you got to be honest, but have faith. That's a Stockdale paradox. Step three, guys, you are going to have visceral responses in life. You're going to have a visceral response. Bottom line is, it's just how we were built. We have visceral responses. Now, what you're looking at in front of you is the keychain on my vehicle. Now, having a dog's a pretty good plan, even though I don't have one. I don't have this because I have a dog. This is a metaphor to pause, P-A-U-S-E. So when I rub it, it tells my mind to pause. Just pause for a second, John. Relax. Relax for a second. Just relax for a second. Pause. Get off the crazy train. Stop being batshit crazy for a second. Just pause and then ask the question, what am I feeling right now? What am I feeling right now? Now, before I talk about this is very, very important. When you're getting batshit crazy in your brain, pause and say, wait a second, how's my biochemistry? Now, your biochemistry is a combination of four things. It's the letters of the compass. When your biochemistry is off, you can't think right. So what controls your biochemistry? It's the letters of the compass, north, south, east, west. Nutrition. Have you been eating well? Did you eat lunch? Okay, if you skip a meal and then you're getting batshit crazy, okay, maybe you got to relax and go eat something. Maybe it's not even authentic what you're feeling. You're just hungry. You're hangry. S is sleep. Have you been getting restorative sleep? So guys, if you're not sleeping well and your mind is off, okay, wait a second. That might not even be authentic. It's just because you're sleep deprived. E is exercise. Are you moving your body in a way that builds your body? Are you building up your body? And W is water. Are you staying hydrated? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, you got to be very careful of these reactions that you have in your life. You have to look at your biochemistry. Okay, you have to be careful with these initial responses. I'll tell you something that's very honest. Okay, I believe when I'm teaching in class, you're getting the best of me. Okay, when I'm a clinician, when I'm at the hospital, the nurses, the docs, the patients are getting pretty much the best of me. That's been my experience. Guess who got the worst of me often? Okay. Often it was the people at home. You got to be very careful of that. I have wounds because of that. Okay. So we have to learn to pause. Now, when you pause, how's my biochemistry? North, south, east, west. Who put Snickers in the chat window? What's the matter with you? We're having a very serious conversation and you're throwing a Snickers. That's no. Judia, troublemaker. Where is she at? Where is she at? Try new. Where is she at? Those commercials are pretty funny, though. When all of a sudden, you know, it's pretty funny. All right. Number one, guys, what's your why? Why do you want to be a PA? Number two, be honest, but have faith. Number three, embrace and appreciate the pause. Appreciate the pause. Whenever I'm getting BSC, what's BSC stand for? Batshit crazy. When I'm feeling batshit crazy, pause. Check your biology. How are you doing? Did you eat? Guys, listen to me. Don't respond when you're batshit crazy. Don't respond. Keep it to yourself. Don't hit text. Don't send the text. Don't send the email. Don't make the phone call. Pause and go eat something. My experience is never one time in my life did I not shoot off a hot email that the next day I put it in draft. I looked at the email the next day. Never once did I say, oh, I should have sent that email yesterday. But every single time I go, thank God I didn't send that email. Thank God I didn't do it yesterday when I'm jacked up. Thank God. All right. Now, when you pause, Here, first and foremost, you got to understand something, guys. Please listen. Please listen. Please listen. You can't think of two things at the same time. It's impossible. So let's just say you're thinking of your test. You're thinking of your pants, your pantry. You're thinking of your interpretation exams. You're thinking of this stuff. Now, what happens is that creates this anxiety. Oh my gosh, what if this? 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 Now, if you stay focused on the antagonism, you can't break the cycle. It gets worse. It's like knocking over dominoes. But if you can pause, if you can pause and say, wait a second, what am I feeling right now? What am I feeling? Okay, I'm afraid. I'm afraid. Anxiety is just fear, right? Anxiety is just a fancy way for saying I'm afraid. Now, if you can pause and say, what am I feeling right now? I'm afraid. Now focus on the fear, and then the antagonist goes away. Let's just focus on your emotional states, because then I can show you how to change them. But if you're staying focused on the antagonism, you can't change it because you're quite not even sure what you're feeling. If you can say, wait a second, pause. Okay, wait. How's my biochemistry? North, south, east, west. Nutrition, sleep, exercise, water. Okay, I'm good. I've eaten. I've been sleeping as good as I possibly can. Okay, I'm really jacked up about this. I'm afraid. Okay, wait. I'm afraid. All right. Now I can help you with that, because you have to understand something. The quality of your life is going to be equal to the habitual emotional states you live in. I'm going to say that again. At the end of your life, the quality of your life is going to be aligned with the habitual emotional states you live in. I don't care if you're a janitor, but if you live with gratitude and blessings and happiness, you lived a great life. And I don't care if you're a cardiothoracic surgeon. If you live flippant and bitter and sarcastic and prideful, you squandered something. So your emotional states, this is way bigger than just a test. This is way bigger than a test. This is how you deal with adversity. So embrace the pause, check your biochemistry and say, what am I feeling right now? Focus on the state, not the antagonism. Now, if I ask you this question, what controls your life? What controls your life? If it wasn't for this, my life would be great. Okay, bottom line is, hold on a second. Be very careful about this question. This question sets you up for victimism. You control your life. You control your life. Nothing else controls you. Nothing. Your health. Don't say the pants. Don't say PA school. Don't say your spouse. You control your life. I'm in control of my own happiness, and so are you. I'm in control of every... Guys, there's a high burnout rate in medicine right now, but you're in control of that. You're not a victim. Set boundaries, okay? Don't put yourself in a position to get burned out. Learn to say no. Learn to say, this is what I can do for this organization. I control my own life. You control your own life. If you say anything else, you're a victim. I control my life. Let's just be very clear about something right now. You don't have to take your boards. You get the privilege to take your boards. Do you understand? There are people in the United States right now who would give their left kidney to be sitting in your seat. You're blessed, man. You're almost through PA school. You're going to be upper middle class for the rest of your life. Guys, I've been a PA for 26 years. I run a business for 10 plus years. How many millions of dollars do you think I've generated? So will you, okay? You're going to generate about $1 million every 7-8 years, okay? By the time you graduate, you're probably going to generate $4 to $5 million. You're going to live a great life. This is all a privilege. You don't got to do anything. You get to. What controls your life? You control your life. Don't outsource that. Okay? It's not the environment. You control your life. I control my life, my success, my failures, my health. I'm complete control. If I'm in a relationship that's not healthy for me, I control that too. I control my life. You control your life. Nothing controls you guys but you. Don't be a victim. Don't let this test kick your ass. This is just a test. You don't have cancer. It's an adversity. It's an adversity. That's all. Now, I have a tattoo on my left leg that says impedimentum est via. Impedimentum est via. What does that mean? It means the impediment is the way. What does that mean? The obstacle is the way. Listen to what I'm going to say right now. If you can hear what I'm going to say right now, your life is going to change if you can internalize this. What happens if for the rest of your life, you make up your mind today? What if for the rest of your life, every adversity that comes in your way, every adversity, every single problem you have from here on out is not a threat to you. It's just a challenge. What if every single problem for the rest of your life is a calling for you to go to your higher self? Nothing presses you more than adversity. Nothing. Okay. I've never worked out harder in my life. Like I kickboxed for a while. I never trained harder than when I knew I had a fight coming up because there was adversity. This test is just an adversity. You can think of it as a threat or a challenge. If you think of it as a challenge, your whole life changes. What if for the rest of your life, every problem you have is a calling and a challenge for you to evolve to your higher self? If you can change your mind to that, then problems become exciting because when you solve them, you're better. Here's the formula. E plus O is R. E plus O is R, meaning that the events in your life, the response that you have contributes to your outcome. The bottom line is, guys, we can only control one thing. I could not control the fact that a hurricane was coming towards my condo. I could not control if the internet was going to go out, but I could control if I drove 90 minutes into Orlando and got away from the storm. Okay. If I drove here and got here and all of a sudden the storm took out the internet here in Orlando, I can't control that outcome. All I got to do is mitigate the risk the best I can. I can control my response. So can you. And when you combine that locus of control, I control my response, and the fact that maybe every problem I have, like the pants, is a calling to evolve me to my best self, everything changes. Maybe it's not about you, and maybe the pants isn't a threat. Maybe it's a challenge. Maybe it's a calling. Now, here's the thing, guys. Whenever you think the problem is out there, whenever you think your problem is external, whenever you think it's the event, that is the problem. That's the primary problem. Whatever you think the problem's out there, that's the problem. You're playing the victim. I mean, one of the biggest problems is we think we shouldn't have problems. Everybody does. Everybody does. And I can tell you my experience is the greatest adversities of my life are the ones that have forged me into the man that I am today. And you too. Your greatest adversities have made you who you are. Now, I posted this on my Facebook wall and I believe it. I swear by this. Did you really have a bad day, or did you have 10 to 20 minutes where you let your thoughts run undisciplined, which led you to a bad vibe that let you get carried away? Did you really have a bad day, or was just a bad moment? Come on, you run this shit. Pay attention. Learn to control your mind. Learn to control your mind. You're not a victim of your mind. You control your mind. I'll tell you a tool that I use all the time. When I'm getting batshit crazy, number one, I check my biochemistry. I always do that. I always do that. Number two, what state am I in? How am I feeling right now? And then I use the mnemonic GOAT, G-O-A-T. G, what does G stand for? Gratitude. I say, what am I really thankful for in my life? Now, gratitude is global. I think of the big things. I'm thankful that I'm a PA. I'm thankful that I'm an educator. I'm thankful that I'm healthy. Okay. I look at the global things. Oh, what does O stand for? Optimism. What am I optimistic about? Okay. Oh, I have this vacation coming next month. I'm writing another book that I'm really excited about. A, appreciation. Who in my life do I deeply appreciate? Then I look at the people who I love and people who are in my life. And then T is thankful. What am I thankful that I own? So bottom line is I run through GOAT, gratitude, optimism, appreciation, thankful. And then I answer the question in a heartfelt way, and then I feel the feelings from it. And then if I'm not better, I do it again. And I just keep doing it until all of a sudden I realize, man, my life is so full of great things. GOAT, because I control my mind. I control what I feed my mind. Just so you guys know, there was a study done that said, if you watch 3 minutes of negative news first thing in the morning, you have an increased chance of saying you had a bad day by 27%. Bless you. By what you feed your mind. I choose to feed my mind with positive, empowering thoughts that allow me to be my best self. Guys, it's a choice. You control your mind. You control your mind. Don't let your mind control you. Your mind is a computer. You program it. So why do you want to be a PA? Look at your why. Number two, you better be honest, but have faith. Everything will be okay. Next, embrace and appreciate the pause when batshit crazy. Look at your biochemistry and say, what am I feeling right now? Focus on your state, not the antagonism. Next, realize I control my life, my success, my failures, my health. I control my reactions to life. That's where my strength and peace come from. I'm in charge of my life. Nothing controls me but me. I control how I use my mind and how I focus it. Now, get this word out of your vocabulary. This is a victimism word. I got to do something. I got to do something. Oh, I got to do something. I got to do something. Just so you guys know, I know there's people under the sound of my voice right now who love playing the victim. They love blaming external circumstances. They just kind of like, we can get addicted to that. And if that's you, where you love to complain about how hard your life is, you know exactly who to run to. And they feed you. They feed this in a way that's almost perverse and incredibly unhealthy. There are people who are under the sound of my voice right now who have an addiction to drama, and they know exactly who to go to get it fed. But that could stop today. Just so you guys know, if you're one of those people that just love the victim as a mindset, poor me, oh my gosh, my life is so hard. Come on, man, you're going to waste your life. You're going to squander opportunities. You're going to wake up one day, and if you have clarity on your behavior, you're going to realize you didn't live 1/50th of what you could have been. And I'll tell you this right now, if you're one of those people that play that victim card, and you're going to be a parent, you're going to teach your kids how to be little victims like mommy and daddy. Or you could break it today. I'm in charge of my life. I'm in charge of my life. I control my life. So when you say, I got to do something, change the O to an E. You don't got to do anything. You get to. You get the privilege to. You don't got to take the test. You get the privilege to. You paid the price. You've spent the hundreds of thousands of dollars and the thousands of hours. I guarantee you, you've probably cried throughout PA training. I sure did. You probably had nights you couldn't sleep. You know, how many times did a doc yell at you, roll your eyes? How many times did you leave rotation going, what the hell am I doing? Am I even in the right field? How many times were you rattled? Think about the time that you opened up your acceptance letter. You got that acceptance email, okay? Think about the times that you've had adversity. Bottom line is, you get the privilege to. You've paid the price. You don't got to do anything. Now, just remember your language matters. Language matters, guys. Get is gratitude. Got is victimism. Drop the got. Okay, I get the privilege to. I get the privilege to. And I'm in control of my life. Now that we're here, what are the three things I recommend you do to actually control that state? Now, the GOAT mnemonic has been very, very effective for me. I'm going to suggest a three-part technique called thought, word, and deed. Thought, word, and deed. Thought, word, and deed. Thought. So how do I control my emotional states? Through thought, word, and deed. How do I control my thoughts? Well, here's one of the tools I use. Here's a circle of concern. Here's a circle of influence. Here's what I can tell you. When something comes into my life, I'm concerned about it, but there's not a damn thing I could do. I let it go. It has no power over me. I don't watch the news ever. Do you know why? Because a lot of things happen on the news that I can't control. So I don't watch the news. Because quite frankly, the news often makes me anxious, scared, and afraid, and I don't want to feel that way because I know the quality of my life is the quality of my emotions. So I focus on the things I can truly influence. And if I can't influence, I give it no power. Guys, I can tell you there are times I fly a lot. I'm about to get on a plane to fly home. Next thing you know, they cancel the flight. My heart rate doesn't go up 3 beats per minute. I can't control it. So all right, I guess there's a reason why I'm supposed to be here. I'll make the best of it. Now, this right here is one of the most important things I'll say to you today. Real solutions will emerge when the questions become more important than the answers. Real solutions in your life will emerge when the questions you ask become more important than the answers. Wait a second. This is profound. Just so you guys know, Albert Einstein said it a different way. He said, real solutions will emerge. Oh, no, he said it this way. He said, the significant problems we face today cannot be solved at the same level of thinking we were at when we created them. And I'm like, what are you talking about? It's exactly what's written here. The real solutions in your life to the real problems that you have, they will emerge when you think different. So what does that mean, John? Ask better questions. If you ask better questions, you get better solutions. Let me tell you something, guys. Every one of you have a list of questions that you ask yourself to solve life adversities. The problem is a bunch of you, me, we generated these questions when we were in our teens. So our questions are something like, why does it always happen to me? How come life is so unfair? How come I get screwed over? These are subconscious questions. But what if we change those questions to more empowering questions like, what am I supposed to learn from this? How am I supposed to grow from this? How is this going to make me a better man, better entrepreneur, better Christian? I'll tell you the three questions that I ask myself right now, and it's been a game changer. This is when it comes to me reacting. I will ask the first question that goes like this: what would God want me to do right now? And it's so funny. Every single time I ask that question, I hear from God, love that other person. Just love them. Love them. I hear that every time. Just love them. The second question I ask is, what would a wise man do right now? And then I put this pen to paper on it. And then the third question I ask is, what do I want to do? There's always a difference there. It's never what God wanted. It's never what wise wanted. And bottom line is, when I start asking those questions, I get a peace over me because now I'm thinking at a high level. Okay, colleagues, you will have significant change in your life when you ask higher caliber questions. How am I supposed to grow as a woman? How am I supposed to grow in grace and class and strength and resilience? How am I going to use this adversity to become the man, the clinician, the husband that I'm called to? When you ask that question, all of a sudden, how am I supposed to study for this test that will allow me to optimize knowledge so I can really help people? Boom, now we're talking. Our focus comes from the questions we ask. Guys, if you ask bad questions, you're going to get bad focus. There's no other way around it. So maybe put pen to paper on what's 3 to 5 questions you could ask that are empowering. Again, my 3 questions are, what would God want me to do right now? What would a wise man want me to do right now? And then what do I want to do? Every time I do that, it makes me look at how superficial I am. Like every time, God, what would God want to do? Love them, love others, just love them. What would wise men do? Well, wise men would do this. Wise men wouldn't do this. Wise men wouldn't. But when you put pen to paper, it almost takes you out of yourself. At least it does for me. So if you ask this question, why does this happen to me? Why does it happen to me? That's a victimism question. And a lot of people ask that. Now, I'm a man of faith. I'm a Christian. I don't push my beliefs on anybody, and I hope I have it in this course, but it's just it's who I am. I believe that all my adversities have caused me to grow. There's no question. I am the person I am today because of my adversities. There's no question. So now I don't believe anything's happening to me. I don't believe anything's happening to me. I believe that every adversity I've had have forged me into the man that I am today, and I'm way better than I would have been. So now I believe there's a God. I know there's a God that loves me very much, and circumstances will happen that will allow me to grow. So I don't say why it's happening to me. I now ask this question. I now ask, why is this happening for me? Why is it for me? Why is this happening for me? What am I supposed to grow? Now, why do you want to be a PA? You better know your why. You better be honest, have faith. You better embrace the pause. Check your biology. Focus on what emotion you're feeling. Remember, you control your life. You control every part of your life. You control your reactions to life. Okay? And that's where your strength and peace come from. Watch what you say, ladies and gentlemen. Okay? Okay, when you say something like, oh my gosh, I can't fail my boards. I can't do it again. Yes, you can. Don't say that. Yes, you can. Oh, I was crushed. No, you had an adversity. The language we use creates its own reality. So be careful and be kind about the language you use. Ladies and gentlemen, don't ever say anything out loud negative about yourself. Don't ever say it. Don't ever say it. If you think it, that's not as bad as if you say it. You say it, it becomes very powerful. Don't say negative stuff. Language matters. I control my thoughts with the questions that I ask and answer to myself. What would God want me to do right now? What would a wise man do right now? What do I want to do? How do I change my emotional states? I do thought, meaning, and motion. Let's talk about meaning. Ladies and gentlemen, you are gifted with the ability to alter meaning. You can make meaning mean anything you want to. Meaning, problems, are they a threat or challenge? If you leave this session today with the mindset of possibly every problem for the rest of my life is a challenge, it's calling in my best self, your life changes. Faith versus fear. What's the difference? What's the difference between faith and fear? Now, they're both imagination. What's the difference? And faith is your imagination directed towards something, whatever that is for you. I mean, my faith is directed towards God. That's where I put my imagination. When things are getting troublesome, I got my focus on something. Okay. I got my imagination focused on something. Fear is when you don't have it focused on something. And the way the human body is made, our mind goes dark. We go to dark things. Okay. Example, David Mustaine, 1983. He was in a rock band. They got a big contract. They were fixing to do great things. Before the contract was executed, the other three band members came to him and kicked him out of the band. He drove from New York City to LA in a bus. When he got to LA, he was so angry, he swore he was going to use every part of his imagination and crush the band that fired him. He was going to destroy them. He was obsessed. So he got back. He found three other band members. They're actually better than the first band. He formed the band Megadeth. They traveled the world many times over. They had adoring fans, sold 25 million albums. In all essence, you'd think he lived a very successful life. But in a tearful interview, he said he feels like his life was a failure because he focused his imagination on crushing the band that kicked him out. Anybody know what band he got kicked out of? Matt knows. He got kicked out of Metallica. They got kicked out of Metallica. And he got kicked out of Metallica, and Metallica sold a few more albums than he did. So he felt like his life was a failure. As opposed to this guy, Pete Best, 1962. He's in a British band. They're doing great things. But the bottom line is he wasn't doing drugs and he wasn't sleeping with the groupies like the other band members. The other bands got a little bit bothered by that. So they had a guy named Ringo Starr come and they kicked him out of the band. And Ringo Starr took over before they became superstars in the world. Now, he had a couple of years of depression, but he got married and had kids. In an interview, he said, I'm happier than I would have been with the Beatles because if I would have been with the band, I never would have met my wife and I never would have met my kids. How he directed his imagination was very different than David Mustaine. We control the meaning in our lives. I can create an empowering meaning from any circumstance in my life. It's all about perspective. I can create a perspective that is empowering to me. Lastly, I change my emotional states with my thought, meaning, and motion. Thought, meaning, and motion. Thought, meaning, and motion. Thought, meaning, and motion. Now, here's the deal, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of us think our emotions control our body. It's exactly opposite. Our bodies control our emotions. No question, absolutely. Here's the deal. If I said to you, okay, listen, I'm going to bring on a person on Zoom right now. They're in the other room, but I have a camera on them. They're major depression. So I'm going to have them come on and talk to you, but we're going to put a camera on them for a second. What's that patient going to look like? Are they standing up? Are they slumped over? How are they breathing? How are they holding their head? How are they talking? You guys all know what someone looks like when they're depressed, okay? The bottom line is our body controls our emotions. So when you're batshit crazy, check your biochemistry, right? Check that. Check what state you're in. But when you are batshit crazy, you got to move your body right away. You got to move your body. You got to get up, move your body, wave your arms, do whatever it takes to not be batshit crazy. And that means radically moving your body immediately. As soon as you start going into a bad headspace, move your body immediately. This is the most effective way to change your state. When they use the word shake it off, it's literal. When you're in a bad state, start shaking your body, get up and move right away. It'll break the cycle. I swear it. I got divorced in 2019. It was horrible. Okay. And I married a girl from PA school. We were study partners. It was very, very difficult. Okay. If I didn't have this tool, I think I would have lost it. You know, when I could feel myself starting to lose it, relax, get up and move around, control these tools. You got to control yourself, dude. You got to stay focused. You got a job to do right now. Moving your body was the single most effective tool. But hold on. You got to remember, you got to believe you're not a victim. Like, you got to believe you're in control, because if you don't believe that, then you probably won't do this. But if you believe you're in control, as soon as you feel the batshit crazy, get up and move your body immediately. Get up, shake around, jump around, do whatever it takes to move your body. And quite frankly, the more radically you move your body, the faster the feelings go away. Don't take my word for it. Tonight, take a pen and hold it between your teeth like this. Give it 3 minutes. What happens is you form a smile with your orbicularis oris muscle. And guess what? 3 minutes later, everything's a little bit lighter. There's studies that show cartoons are funnier if you hold a pen like this. And then if you hold a pen like this, you form a little puss face, everything sucks a little bit. Or try this. For 3 minutes, just go E, 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 E. Every time you say E, you're smiling. And after 3 minutes, everything's a little bit lighter. Then go U, U, U. And then 3 minutes later, everything sucks a little bit. Here's the mantra: move a muscle, change a thought. Move a muscle, change a thought. Move a muscle, change a thought. You move your body, you're going to change how you think. Don't be a victim. Control your body. Control your mind. If you can't control your mind, control your body. I was talking to someone today who, little anxiousness about her. And one of the things I advised her to do was, she was talking a little fast. There was some other features going on, but I basically said, slow down your speech. Just slow down a little bit. That's controlling your body. Okay. When you move a muscle, you change your thoughts. I hope you can hear me. This is, I would say, if there's only one thing you're going to leave with today, this has been the most helpful for me. Because when I get batshit crazy, I can get batshit crazy. And the cycle is easier to break right at the start. Okay. Colleagues, why do you want to be a PA? Seriously, why? Are you ego? Are you ego or altruism? If that ego's there, yeah, the test is going to be pretty hard. Maybe change your focus a little bit. Be honest and have faith. Just be honest. Everything is going to be okay. Know your NCC. Be honest about your abilities. Embrace the pause. Check your biology. Ask, what am I feeling right now? Identify your feeling and get away from the antagonism. I control my life, my success, my failures, my health. Don't be a victim, guys. You own your life. Don't be a victim. Don't be a victim. You will regret it. You will regret it. You're in charge. Just so you guys know, I acknowledge something. You cannot control your past. We all have a past. So do I. You can't control your past. It's almost like if someone leaves a baby on your front porch and rings your doorbell and runs away. You go up and there's a baby there. Wait. You're not responsible. You're not to blame for that baby being there. You're not to blame. You're not to blame for what happened in the past, but you're responsible for how you live today. So you're responsible for how you behave today. I control my reactions to life. That's where my strength and peace come from, because I'm in charge. Language matters. Ladies and gentlemen, don't talk negative about yourself. Don't ever do it. Don't do it. Don't vocalize it. And stop using the word, I got to do something. You get to. You're privileged and you're in charge of your life. You're not a victim. I control my thoughts with the questions that I ask and answer to myself. Colleagues, consider a new set of questions. Put them on a 3x5 card and make that your default questions. Whenever you're batshit crazy, you made a commitment. I got some new questions. Create a powerful meaning in your life. It's all about perspective. It's all about growth and move a muscle, change a thought. Cool. Final thoughts here. Robert Folsom wrote a number of books on psychology. It's kind of like the chicken soup for the soul. Now, he wrote one book where he told a story that he was a summer camp counselor. He was 22 years old, and every single night he got the same thing to eat. It was hot dogs and sauerkraut. Now, the kids at the summer camp were turning over every day, but the people who worked there got the same food. So he's yelling, bitching. And the last week he said, I hate this job. I'm going to quit. This place sucks. He's really getting jacked up. There's an old watchman who says, you know what your problem is, Folsom? What? Your problem is you don't know the difference between an inconvenience and a problem. That's your problem. And he's like, well, who are you? And then he realizes, he looked at this guy's forearm. This guy had a bunch of numbers tattooed. So this guy was in the concentration camps at Auschwitz. You're bitching about your food. You don't know the difference between an inconvenience and a problem. And he said this, listen, he said this. He said, a lump in the oatmeal, a lump in the throat, and a lump in the breast, they ain't the same lump. And we can have an appalling lack of perspective, This is a test, guys. It's nothing more. It's just an adversity. Don't make it bigger than it is. This is not this. This is this. This is just a test. And if you fail the test, you'll be fine. Get out of yourself. It's not about you. It's about your patience. Okay? I'm just telling you, when you make something bigger and it has more control over you, you will be fine. Everybody's fine. You'll be fine. But don't make it bigger than it is. Conclusion. It's your life. It's my life. Guys, when I finally realized I'm completely in control of my life and started acting that way, you know, the divorce was necessary. And it was a good divorce. It was good. We were different people. But I had to control my life. It was necessary. Guys, you got this. You got this. I can tell you, I'm a little biased. This Board of You course is the best on the planet. There's nothing better than this, at least for most people, especially people who struggle. I am giving you the tools that you need. That precision is a goal mine. You got the right tools. You're in control of your life. Stay focused. Ask empowering questions. Manage your state.